Hi everyone, myself Sudheer. I am senior tech lead at Endurance. So today we are gonna discuss the art of decomposing a monolith. So before jumping into the talk, how many of you guys actually deal with monolith on your day-to-day work? Good, interesting. How many actually started transitioning to microservices? Oh, almost 10-20%. Good. So this talk is for you guys. So who are we? So at Endurance, we help small and medium businesses to come online, be it a domain name, hosting, website builder. See, we provide you with a lot of tools that help any small business to come online in a very short time. And we have like variety of popular brands. Primarily, you guys would have heard about HostGator, Bluehost, BigRock. So, and I hope you guys already have a domain already purchased from us. And we are like largest in the sense we currently manage around 40 million domain names, and we have 55,000 hosting servers across 25 data centers. So this is the scale at which we operate globally. And today we are specifically looking at our APAC story. Like, I'm going to take you guys through my journey over the last 3 years on decomposing a monolith, which is our one of the core platform in APAC. How we transitioned in the last 3 years from a monolith to a microservice architecture, and where are we currently, and in this process, what are the challenges we have faced. So as you see, like, this platform is actually a $70 million platform, which is generating like $70 million revenue annually across with 10 million domain names, active domains, and we have around 1200 APIs that are exposed from this monolith. So it has 1 million lines of code. So you can imagine the complexity. So this platform is built over 20 years now, and it is very tricky for someone new to even make new changes in this code base. So there is a complexity we are dealing with, and we receive traffic around 20,000 requests per minute on an average scale. At the same time, we have 500 GB live data. So primarily we use Postgres for our transactional data, and we have around 1.5 terabytes of historical data that is currently archived. And these are the brands that primarily operate on top of this platform. So BigRock is a retail model wherein any of the individual users like you and me can go and purchase a domain name, get the hosting package from BigRock. At the same time, we have a unique B2B model called Reseller Club, wherein we cater to the web professional needs, and they buy bulk domain names and hosting servers from us and resell to their customers, using our customized billing platform and other services we offer to this web pros. Yeah. So what are we gonna cover today? So being a happy monolith family for 20 years, why did we even start thinking of going towards microservices driven architecture? What is the need that has driven us to go to microservice? And we'll see the common mistakes we did, and we don't want you guys to repeat if you are doing the same. At the same time, we'll actually see in detail how we transitioned and successfully pulled out one of the important microservices from this monolith, and the challenges and the tools and technologies we have covered during this transition. And then we'll also cover the scaling redundancy aspects of the microservice, not just pulling the microservice, but how did we successfully manage to get more scale. So microservices won't happen overnight, right? So before that, we'll see the challenges we had with the current monolithic platform. So as you are seeing, right, so the main limitation we have faced, so when I joined the team 3 years back, we are running out of DB connections. So we have Postgres master database, wherein it gives like 50,000 queries per second throughput. So we actually spent a lot of time in tuning the connection pool. We moved to Hikari CP from a legacy connection pooler on the Java side. We spent a lot of time in evaluating various data sharding capabilities of Postgres itself, but we are not successful. We have hit our max capacity on the DB side, and we have tuned the parameters such a way we get the best throughput of our production database server, which is around 400 DB connections. So ideally, the DB connections should be like number of CPUs into two. That's the max any DB server can perform to its best. But we have a 80 core production server, and we already like touched the max limit any database server can give the throughput. So we hit the scale of the database server. And the next important limitation we have came across is the Java heap size. So this platform is Java based. So we initially, when we joined, like, it is like we have allotted 4 GB max heap. but we started seeing out of memory errors when there is spike in traffic. As and when we integrate new features, the heap used to get out of memory. We used to get out of memory errors very frequently. And we like suspected, as any developer, we started looking at, are there any memory leaks, but in vain. We are not able to figure out any potential code problem that would have caused the memory leak. So it is indirectly it is indicating that as the number of services or the objects are loaded in the memory, the need for the JVM heap kept on increasing. And eventually, like we again, the max JVM heap you can allot is 12 GB. Beyond 12 GB, any Java process at this point cannot perform well. Be it Cassandra, Elasticsearch, beyond 12 GB, you can never tune a Java process. So in those aspects also, we have already kind of in the middle way to touch the max limit of a JVM heap size. And other challenge with the monolith is the you cannot scale a particular functionality, right? So during a promo or a festive season, our customers try to buy new domains. Let's say there's a new TLD called .tech launched. So we see more hits for the initial lookups, like I want to buy Sudheer.tech. So similarly, the customers will be primarily doing this lookup operation to further buy a hosting package or to get their website hosted on our servers. So in order to do this, basically we are not able to scale just that particular functionality because you need to deploy this monolith. And then even if you put like more instances of the Java code, you still have the limitation at the DB layer. So we already hit the max limit at Postgres. We are in the middle way of hitting the max limit of any good Java process. And as you see, this monolith has various modules intercoupled, right, intertwined. So it does user management, product management, and whatnot. So you can imagine what all it does with the 1 million lines of code. And again, same thing, like you cannot even, the other common mistake or common issues we see is when a developer intended to touch particular functionality, say I want to enhance the billing capability for one of my customers, I cannot do it without impacting the other modules because end of the day, it's the same code. You need to go through the testing for the full monolith and then see if it's not breaking any other workflows. And we see many outages related to unintentional breakage of code from a developer standpoint. So these are the challenges we have with this current monolith platform. And then we started thinking of microservices. So how does a microservice help to solve this particular problem? So there is something called vertical scaling, which we covered. Similarly, horizontal scaling, which is primarily applicable or easy to achieve in NoSQL databases. But in Postgres world, it is very tricky to scale your transactional DB into multiple distributed systems. There are some solutions like Postgres Excel, Citus Data, which we have evaluated, but again, they do not suit our needs because it's again a legacy system. You cannot redesign the full system as per the expectations of this data sharding technologies. At the same time, the microservice will give you the flexibility to choose your own technology, right? So if it is a proper transactional kind of workload you have, you can choose to use Postgres or MySQL database. Similarly, if you are doing simple search functionality or you want to like get like quick lookup functionality, you can use any of the NoSQL databases like MongoDB, Elasticsearch, Cassandra. So you as you go towards microservice architecture, you get the flexibility of choosing your own tech stack. At the same time, you can loosely couple your teams. So currently, we have our own development team of 30 to 40 people working on the monolith code base, and all the developers should make sure that they do not break each other's code. Like when I'm committing something, I should not break my peer's code, right? At the same time, we also have this same CI/CD module. Like you can only deploy your code along with others' changes. Even though we are agile, it's always like complex to make sure you don't break someone else's code. So that once you go to microservice architecture, you get the flexibility to choose the tech stack with smaller teams where you get more velocity and polyglot programming. So wherein you can choose your own tech stack and you need not just depend on Java tech stack. You have the flexibility to have a diverse team who are specialized in particular functionality and scale it to whatever extent you need. At the same time, yeah, you can have this like versioning, releasing, capabilities tied to that particular microservice, right? You can easily deploy the microservice without worrying about how the monolith is impacted because now you are loosely coupled. Yeah. So we'll see the common mistakes which I noticed. Also, like I think in the IT industry, people do these mistakes. So the first big mistake we do is sharing the database. So we think, okay, there is an issue at JVM layer. we know there is a, like we already hit the max limit of database, but why don't we just rewrite some of the Java code, deploy in a separate like CI/CD module using dedicated Git repo. But underlying, you are still sharing the same DB. What it means when there is a downtime for the database or you want to do some kind of upgrade to the database, you are actually impacting multiple services. Along with the intended functionality, you are gonna break something else. So this is still a monolith architecture for me with just an additional steps. It's not a microservice architecture. People may, some developers initial stages, they may assume it's a microservice architecture, but yeah, as long as you're sharing the DB, it's a monolith with additional steps. So the other mistake we did in, like in order to get this speed, like we are growing like we are expanding our APAC platforms, we are building new front-end experience panels for resellers and retail customers. So in a need to grow, we started building these orchestration layers, wherein we try to like duplicate some of the functionalities like authentication. You can do some kind of transformations, like if I had to pull user details of Sudheer, I'll query for user Sudheer along with another API called get address details. So you will call multiple API calls to the monolith, you aggregate these responses and return it back to the front end. So these kind of transformations and some kind of caching ability so that you don't hit the max throughput of the monolith, we kept on building these orchestration layers, which ultimately, again, it may help you temporarily, but in the long run, again, you have a bottleneck at the monolith layer. So it's still falling in the monolith with additional steps category. Underlying monolith is not scaling, but you're just building orchestration layers to get the immediate benefit of speeding up or taking more throughput on the client side. So now we'll take one particular use case wherein we successfully pulled as a microservice and how we actually got the scale benefits out of the microservice. So how, like when you go back again, think about microservices, like what you should actually reflect on is discovering your first microservice. That's the challenge we also had. Like how did you choose the microservice? Okay, you are thinking microservices will help in adding more scale to the monolith. But how did you choose the first microservice? So in my case, we applied this strategy called ice cream scoop. So what it means effectively, you prioritize your business critical functionality. For example, during promos, as I highlighted, there is more traffic for lookups, registrations, compared to, let's say, addition of new products or integrating with more payment gateways. There is more traffic coming on the lookups. And it is very important for our business, for the user to look up the domain and then do further purchase of products with us. Else he may choose to go to our competitor, right? If we cannot give him the ease of looking up and then purchasing on our platforms, he'll choose the competitor. So that's where we identified domain lookup as one of the first potential microservice that we can pick up, and we'll see immediate business growth and also like the scale that we required. At the same time, in your case, if you have multiple critical functions, say you need even to scale your payment module. So you prioritize and figure out the efforts versus benefits. So what is the engineering and operational efforts you need to put in to build the microservice versus what is the monetary benefit and also other scale benefits you'll get with that exercise. So try to do thorough analysis so that you can easily justify to your business and also your tech lead that this is what I'm gonna pull as a microservice and it will help in scaling so and so. If required, if possible, if you put monetary value, it will help you even to validate once you go live. Is it really adding value to the business? And given that I covered ice cream scoop, there are other strategies too. The other popular strategy is nuclear strategy, wherein you rewrite the whole monolith, like you build a parallel team who does the full rewrite of this monolith and then go like a big bang launch. But most of the cases, if the monolith is very old and you are like doing like more and more features every month on month, it is not a feasible solution, right? So you cannot rewrite the full monolith. By the time you rewrite, let's say you take 2 years to rewrite the full monolith, there may be more changes happening in the monolith. So it's like a race between the old monolith and you need to keep up the pace in the new team. So you are never gonna go live. But it works for some companies. In my initial stage, we did that, but again, it won't be an agile model. You need to go like a big bang launch, also have a time wherein you don't make changes in the monolith. In an agile model, that won't work. Nuclear strategy may not work. So this is like, okay, now that we identified the microservice, how will you prep up? This first we'll look at from the dev perspective. what should the developer do to make this monolith future-proof? So what we adopted is something called modular monolith. So it's a Java platform. So we applied this concept called Maven modules, wherein you have the flexibility to write more code in the new frameworks. Let's say we don't have historically Spring and Hibernate in our code base. So with Maven modules, you can actually have multiple projects under the same Git repo and properly isolated. So you can choose something like, we have built one common module to interact with database, ActiveMQ, and also other third-party registries. We built a commons package which can be shared across, say, modules or future microservices, so that you are building this new system with the attitude that you are going to pull it as a microservice at some time when there is a need. At the same time, you cannot avoid the old code, right? You have already a lot of functionality built over 15 years. You cannot get rid of the code overnight or even within 1-2 years. So you may have to still interact with the legacy code to get some of the functionalities working. But at the same time, you have the advantage to write new APIs using the modern frameworks and modern protocols. For example, you want to introduce gRPC. Right now, ours is a REST-based framework. So with this approach of Maven modules, I can easily create a new module, let's say user management, using gRPC protocol and whichever framework, Spring Boot, whichever I want to use. At the same time, then how are we interacting with the legacy classes? So there is a popular design pattern called facade pattern, wherein what it says, you abstract your old system, primarily using interfaces. So you build loose coupling between the new modules and the old modules, applying facade pattern, wherein the new code can talk to the old code, but not the other way. So never write the code like again two-way. If you write two-way, again you are stuck. If the old code is invoking the new code, again you are stuck in the monolith intertwining and tight coupling. So you need to build loosely coupled modules, introducing new interfaces wherever you need to interact with the legacy code, add new interfaces in the legacy code, and couple them using dependency injection frameworks like Spring, and you can easily interact from the new modules to the legacy framework. So at any moment, if I have to pull a microservice out, say user management as a microservice, I have the new APIs written, there may be some APIs still using the legacy code, but again, it's lesser work compared to rewriting everything. I already put the platform wherein I can easily pull out the new microservice. So using these two, we applied these two particular concepts, Maven modules and facade pattern, and we made our system ready to be pulled as a microservice. Like we have put the path to get the first microservice out. So as I was telling, so we choose domain lookup service as our first microservice. And we have chosen Cassandra as database for this particular lookup service. So out of the 1200 APIs, actually 10 APIs cater to this particular functionality. And the amount of traffic this lookup traffic receives is almost like 1/3 of our production traffic. The whole platform, if at all 1100 APIs are receiving 12,000 requests per minute, the domain lookup functionality itself, the 10 APIs constitute to 8,000 requests per minute. So that's why it's easy for us even to identify this critical functionality and start putting path to pull it out. And we have chosen Cassandra because it's a read-heavy API and there is no transactional functionality that we require. So we have evaluated Redis versus Cassandra, and this is a critical service, so we want very high availability compared to consistency. So eventually we have chosen Cassandra as a data store for this microservice. And we start, and this is called polyglot persistence, right? So you get the flexibility to write with your own technology. In this case, we have chosen Java because, again, we have traditionally developed most of the backend in Java. But at the same time, you have the flexibility to build with Golang or Python, whichever is relevant for this microservice. And the data store also, you should be very cautious what you are choosing. End of the day, you need better performance from the microservice compared to monolith. If the old APIs are performing better than the new APIs, definitely your users or business won't use the new code. So you should make sure you choose the right technology. In our case, there is no transactional nature of data required. So we had the luxury to choose between the popular NoSQL databases, and we went ahead with Cassandra. At the same time, there is one more interesting pattern. So this pattern is also a popular architectural pattern. It's called command query responsibility segregation. So in the initial transition, or whenever you are pulling more and more microservices, if the microservice, for example, this monolith also has references to some of the tables we have migrated from Postgres to Cassandra. So you need a bridge, like as and when you cut more microservices, migrate your tables or data to another data store, you should also think of how does the old functionality not impact it. The monolith should not break when I just pull the domain lookup out. So in order to make sure, so you can periodically sync the updates that are happening in the microservice. Actually, it's a real-time stream. Either using Kafka or ActiveMQ, you can stream the real-time updates happening in your microservices to the monolith so that the functionality doesn't break in your existing system. So this particular pattern helped us, and it's very popular. Like, so that when you have more microservices, you need not worry about the impact on monolith. You keep streaming the data, so that your monolith still continue to function. If there are users still on the monolith platform for the existing API, they still continue to function. Yeah. So this is one part. And then the main part is, okay, now that you have a production system running happily for several years, how do you actually migrate the user or the traffic to the microservice? So in our case, we have introduced a new endpoint for the microservice. To redirect any lookup traffic, we started publicizing to our users with advanced notice. Okay, this is a new endpoint which will give you better performance and also scale compared to the monolith. You start advertising your new endpoint for the microservice. At the same time, you need to be sure that there will be users always on the old system, right? Coming through the load balancer that you already have on top of the monolith. So make sure you like strategically migrate the traffic to the new microservice. So we have adopted something like a canary deployment slash A-B testing. What it means, so whatever traffic is coming for domain lookup on the old endpoint, make sure you do like weighted or incremental traffic migration. We used the concept in HAProxy to add weighted load balancing kind of concept, wherein we send like partial traffic. Any traffic coming to domain lookup on the old platform, you migrate 10% of traffic to the new microservice so that you can have the production testing. At the same time, if something goes wrong, you can always roll back. As an engineer, we should be ready for production issues, right? So don't just think of happy path that microservice will solve everything and it will be running without issues, right? There will be more issues that you discover only in production, because in dev testing, nothing comes out. So yeah, so make sure you migrate the traffic incrementally. At the same time, these are the aspects that we primarily focused. So once we made this microservice live around December 2016, we actually made sure that it is the microservice is highly available. It is giving correct response in production with various types of payload. We compared, okay, this old monolith is giving this response for this particular lookup. For .tech, it is giving this response for Sudheer. The same response is coming for in the new microservice. Similar response is coming when someone hits the new microservice. At the same time, performance, like monitor, like, okay, is the performance as expected from your microservice? Is it performing poorly? Did you write bad code or did you improve the code quality in this migration slash refactoring? And this particular screenshot I have taken from current production. This is, we use ELK for the log analysis. So as you can see, this is primarily like structured as per the RED principle. The first graph is the rate of traffic. So the traffic coming to the old endpoint at that moment of line is 700. There are 700 requests per minute coming on the old endpoint versus 900 requests coming on the new endpoint. So this is primarily indicating, okay, there are still users coming through the old endpoint, but right now we migrated all the traffic to the new code base. So this is indicating people are still yet to use our new endpoint that was publicized. At the same time, the error count. So this is a non-200 response codes that both the old endpoint and the new endpoint is returning. So this is to make sure that you didn't increase the error count or frustration of your users, right? You should always at least make sure it is in line. You don't get a shock that there are more errors and users get frustrated. So just keep an eye on the rate of errors. Like this is like 20 like failures per minute kind of, right? In both the new and old endpoint, it's similar, roughly similar set of failures. At the same time, the response time, as I was telling, right? When the people are hitting directly the new endpoint, the response times are better compared to when they come from the monolith. Why? Because you have an extra hop of HAProxy when we did the migration in our case. But yeah, there may be other approaches that will suit you to do the migration as a A-B testing model. So that's where you see there is a approximately 200 to 300 milliseconds latency added by the network hop. So once users, all users migrate to new endpoint, they get the benefit of faster response times and no latency. So this is how everyone like should monitor, right? We should not just deploy the code and think everything will work magically. Just make sure we proactively have this tool set to even we run periodical health checks in order to ensure the correctness is good even with more and more versions of the microservice. We periodically run automation tests, API tests as a scheduled health check. And this is the benefit we got by pulling the lookup service, right? So as you can see, the monolith platform at this moment when I took the screenshot, it is receiving roughly 8,000 requests per minute. This is a screenshot from New Relic. We use New Relic for primarily the application monitoring and Kibana and ELK stack to check the logs and see how it is done at load balance level. And you see the domain lookup is receiving roughly 4K requests per minute, the new microservice. So effectively, there is a 1/3 gain in the monolith. Now the monolith can take, can give you more throughput effectively because we successfully isolated the database, isolated the Java layer, including the load balancer. So now we have the breathing space in the monolith that it can take extra load that it is serving earlier. We can use the bandwidth for new functionality. So this is our journey in migrating the first microservice, but we didn't stop there. Then we started thinking, okay, now that we are excited with this benefit, we wanted to see what is the next potential microservice that will help us to scale more. Then we started looking at the orchestration layers I was highlighting, right? So the redundancy or the duplication happening across engineering teams primarily is around the auth service. At the same time, with the growing needs of security, there is a demand from our resellers and customers to have multi-factor authentication, enabling Google Auth as two-factor authentication. At the same time, it's the need of the hour that everyone do social login. Like no one likes to go and register, right? No manual registrations. We want to do social login to easily sign up on any particular application. So to get these benefits, we started evaluating variety of open source authentication services. We evaluated KeyClock, Auth0, Okta. Finally, we have chosen KeyClock as our solution because it suited our needs. We have a detailed metrics where we compared the feature set available across the open source authentication service. And this particular KeyClock service works on the basis of OAuth protocol, which means user can generate a JWT and then use that particular token to invoke any of our microservices directly from the front end. So traditionally we do basic auth, which means every time you make an API call, you need to pass your secret or API key. But in this new approach, we are giving the benefit to the customers wherein you use our secret to initially generate a token. Once the token is generated, you can use the token directly from the browser. If you are like using our APIs and selling something on your like client applications, you can easily integrate from the client browser, set the token in a cookie or the relevant place in the browser so that the token gets passed on with every API call through authorization header. It reaches to the monolith or the microservice depending on which API you are like querying, and you can get the benefit of reusing the same authentication service across different microservices. So this will be like a centralized authentication service, but yeah, we need to make sure again it's very highly available and it won't impact your systems if there is any issue. And also going forward, as and when you build more and more microservices, the need for inter-microservice communication will also increase. CQRS pattern, as I explained, will solve some particular backward compatibility with the monolith. But what about, let's say, if there is a genuine need for registration, domain registration module to talk to payment module? So you need some kind of security between the microservices. So that also can be achieved seamlessly by JWT token, the JSON web token. So to be more secure, we can use something like JWE, JSON web encrypted token. So this particular concept will help even when you grow with more and more microservices, you can take advantage of your centralized auth service. So given that we saw the first successful microservice and the next potential microservice which we are working on, we also want to cover quickly our learnings with respect to scaling the microservice itself. So traditionally, we use bare metal deployments. So we do rolling upgrades wherein you take the node out of load balancer, deploy the code, put it back to the load balancer, and we repeat that process on all our production web nodes. So it is time taking. It takes roughly 20 minutes to deploy any code change to our production across 5 web nodes. So, and also the main like pain point for us with the bare metal deployments is the time spent in upgrading tech stack. So we are a Java tech stack, right? Primarily, we want to upgrade from Tomcat 7 to Tomcat 9 because of the CentOS limitations with OS 6 version. We are not able to move easily from Tomcat 7 to Tomcat 9. Similarly, there will be other tech stacks which are tightly coupled to the operating system or other dependencies that are installed on the machine itself. So it makes both the devs and sysad life difficult in terms of upgrading any tech stack, because you need to repeat the same activity across all your production systems, which is time consuming. Also, we over-provision the hardware. So as you can see, right, we have a 24 GB and around 24 CPUs on our production hardware, and we are only able to take advantage of 6 GB RAM. Out of the 24 GB RAM available, we are not able to utilize the full capacity. And the other reason being, we are PCI compliant, so you cannot deploy more than one service on a bare metal. So that also restricts us in terms of utilizing the hardware. At the same time, CPU is definitely underutilized. It's primarily like, even we have high number of cores, so we are not able to utilize all the capacity that is available on the hardware. So the solution our system architects came up with is the de facto standard is Kubernetes, right? And also, like, we started containerizing our applications. So with containerization, the benefits primarily are, you can, like, the developer can have the Docker file ready with all the tech stack requirements he needs, and the sysad can primarily focus on primarily managing the orchestration layer and how to scale your application. So it will help you in doing faster tech stack upgrades. And other pain point I'm sure you guys also facing will be the similarity between staging and prod, right? If you are using bare metal deployments, typically, like, most of the complaints I heard is, okay, my staging is not similar to prod, so whatever I tested, it's working in staging, but nothing works in prod, and we had to roll back the code. So that happens because you don't have similar tech stack. For example, you have different Tomcat versions on staging and production, or you might have compromised on the upgrading OS in your staging. So all the typical issues between to make the staging and production similar is, like, very challenging for any IT company, right? So this particular thing can be solved if you containerize your app. At the same time, we are actually using OpenShift, OKD version of OpenShift, which helped us to segregate both staging and production hardware. Like, we have a cluster of nodes wherein you can segregate easily using the namespaces and labeling them as staging and production infra, so that you can utilize this same infra for both staging and production with proper segregation. So, and also Kubernetes helps you in the optimized infra utilization. So it can be like, there may be, historically there is Mesos, but now I think Kubernetes is a de facto standard, no debate there. And we have deep dive sessions if you guys already attended some of the sessions. And it helps you to auto scale. And also, primarily, it helped us to get this out of the box canary deployment, A-B testing kind of CI/CD capabilities without much thought process or writing customizations. So all these features are out of the box, and there are many more service mesh and other interesting features in Kubernetes itself, which will help you to transition to microservices. So given that we saw what we did so far, this is what we are going to achieve in next 2 months. So this particular architecture, we are calling it as 2.0. So wherein we are introducing an API gateway called Kong. So primarily, we evaluated AWS API gateway, Kong, Tyke. So there are various API gateways available, open source and also paid versions on cloud. For our needs, we evaluated both the cost aspect and extensibility perspective. We have chosen Kong. We have written our own custom plugins to do rate limiting, to interact with the centralized auth service. So the flow, it will look like the client will enter our ecosystem using a JWT, which is secure in itself. And then any request coming through the gateway will be rate limited using the Redis as a data store. We currently rate limit by IP. So if you hit more than 500 requests by IP per minute, we primarily rate limit at this layer itself. So the request won't be forwarded to the microservice. And every request after getting rate limited, after passing the rate limiting check, we forward it to the centralized auth service, in this case key clock, wherein we verify is it the token generated by our own key clock or not. So we do some kind of signing. We call it Java web, JSON web token signed token. So wherein you can verify is the token is the source of truth is key clock or not. Once it is verified, then we also currently building a caching layer, wherein if the particular API with the relevant payload is already available in our caching layer at Kong level. We return the response directly from the caching layer. So it need not even come to your microservice. So yeah, so then once if it is not available in the caching, it will forward to the relevant microservice or the monolith platform itself. So this particular architecture we successfully deployed in staging. Right now we are gonna make it live in next 2 months. So the key takeaways I want you guys to remember from this talk is just reflect on your current platform, see if there is a really a need for microservice. If at all you are a small, you are operating at small scale, or you have only one particular functionality to scale, don't think of microservices as it only adds complexity, right? Just see if it makes sense for you. If at all it makes sense, then what is the microservice? Do thorough analysis with efforts versus benefits. What are the like challenges or monetary benefits you will get with the microservice you are thinking of? And containerize your application. Don't just go with the traditional way. Try to containerize your application even if it is monolith, so that you can have identical staging prod environments. At the same time, take advantage with faster tech stack upgrades. And use Kubernetes or any other flavor of Kubernetes to manage the orchestration layer to get the benefit of infrastructure utilization and auto scale capabilities. And if feasible, if it makes sense to you, if you have a lot of redundancy, start using API gateway. It also helps you to abstract whenever if I have to pull a new microservice out of the monolith, I can abstract my user, because earlier when we transitioned, we had to create a new endpoint. But if you are using an API gateway, you can easily route the traffic, abstracting the user, and then forward it to the relevant microservice. Thank you all.